40 minutes left and I have to be at CUNY at 8:30. So we do have the 40 minutes. I would like to go with you through an abstract and do this in an exercise that is a little bit worked and go through an abstract that I'm currently editing. It's one that is now on my plate and do a real life exercise. How I would work with it. It's probably already in a pretty good condition, and explain what goes into an abstract after a title. That's what we discussed last time. And then we do a online editing together as an exercise today. Today is the abstract day. And then we go into the blended version of the course next time after I send the syllabus today, tomorrow. It's not a difficult task, but I need to find 3 hours to do it. Just from last time, and maybe to spend 10 minutes on or so, are there other titles that we could go through to again work a bit, or have you had any other thoughts on your titles? I asked you to send some titles, but we can do it now. If you have a title, I could type it, I assume, somewhere. Yeah, I could type it in a document and share that document with you. And then we could jointly think through how to further improve a title. Is there any follow-up on your titles from last time? Okay, anyone who has a title? Do you not dare to discuss your titles, or do you feel they are already perfect as they can be? I'm happy to move on to the abstract, and it's then more frontal teaching, but my feeling was last time we went through a third of the titles in this class and the other two-thirds. And even the third we looked at, I don't think we got there quite. Some improvement when we thought about what we can do to make it a strong title, but be not yet the best version that the title could be for your papers. Did anyone send me a title? Okay, it's an offer, right? It's an offering from me, and it's potentially useful. But if you feel your titles are strong, that's good. We will check at a later point. So let me do a session then today on abstract writing, and let's revisit titles, and we can also revisit this one paper that is really, it's a true life case. It's on my laptop open. I owe it to investigators. They have drafted it, and we can look at this title as an example. It's a title from our own work, and we can go through the abstract jointly, and I will explain what the different sections mean and why the abstract is important and even critical. So here is the paper. Let me know if you can see it. Is it visible and large enough for you?
Yes.
Awesome. So look, this is a title page. There's already a lot wrong here, which I will just remark on. But let me show you a professional title page. It needs to include names, all affiliations, and it needs to include an address. Typically, different journals have different provisions in this regard, but it should typically include an address with a physical address, a telephone number, an email of corresponding author, right? So in our world, as you know, the main credit for a paper goes to the first author. That's the person who has really done the work. And the last author, that's the senior person who typically had the idea, had the thought, has probably raised funding for a study, so is the PI on the grant that supports the research. The corresponding authorship is important because it's really where a lot of the responsibility lies, who gets the email back from the journal requesting a revision. And what we are doing sometimes in this world where we have two places physically that are the prominent places, and also by the sort of incentive scheme at the University of Heidelberg, find a higher weight than the middle authors, Heidelberg in one formula that makes sense to me, assigns 50% of the impact factors in the incentive scheme to the first author, 50% to the last author, and middle authors get the portion that is the impact value divided by all authors, by the total author count. That's for the budget incentive that institutes are facing, but it also reflects on academic CVs, right? In our field, in medicine, in public health, in global health, first and last author are the critical positions. The corresponding authorship is typically one of these two. And often now when we have larger teams, and somehow it doesn't seem fair that there's one first author and one last author, what can we do? And the three things that we can do is, first of all, have a start, second author who is identified as an equal first author, have a start, secondly, last author who is identified as an author, but also corresponding authorship carries some weight. So that's just a side comment here, but on this title page, and let's start with that and then move on to the abstract. What is missing here, right? What I would write back to Shaukat, the curator, an excellent scientist with a PhD in molecular biology, a MSc from the London School in epidemiology, and has worked for many years with us at Clinton Health Access Initiative. So I would feedback here, it needs full affiliations that is missing. We need a address and a corresponding authorship, which should probably be Shaukat, who was the data manager on this study. Let's look at this title, the causal costing analysis. Also costing as of test and treat for ART clients, evidence from a randomized batch health systems implantation trial in Swaziland. Any thoughts regarding this title before I give you my thoughts?
I wonder if the four ART clients is really necessary, because I mean, depending on where you publish it, I mean, test and treat, I guess in the world of HIV, you know what test and treat is. So I'm just
very good. Yeah. Totally agree. And you're following here a general rule of good editing. Redundant information should be out, right? It is redundant. And test and treat, maybe, you know, if you're outside the HIV sector, but let's find better words here. I also, it's too long in my opinion, the causal, and let's not do this. So just another little tip, this is sort of practical tips here that I can pass on, and it's based even on evidence. Capitalization is not a good idea because it's harder to read than normal font. So I would not capitalize the title. I typically on PowerPoint slides do not capitalize the main title. I do capitalize the subtitle, but this is with the conscious consideration that the subtitle should be downplayed. This is where I write formally what type of estimator I'm showing, for instance, right? So I write causal effect size estimate with 95% confidence intervals in the subtitle. Boring information, my title would either be a declarative sentence or a theme, and that one I write in bold and not capitalized. The same is true, of course, in paper writing, do not capitalize. So the total effect of HIV test and treat. It's also clear. So thank you for that. Any other ideas? So this was exactly the right idea. Get out for art clients. And I think causal costing analysis, I don't like as much as what I've done now here. The causal effect of HIV test and treat, which is what we're doing. Analysis is a scientific process. But we want to tell the reader what our result is. The result is the causal effect. It's clear that we're doing some kind of analysis, but the scientific process is not what will excite editors or reviewers. But what are we giving to the world? This is a new effect size estimate the world does not have before the paper will be published, which is the causal effect of HIV test and treat on costs. Any other thoughts? So thank you, great point.
Randomized step wedge health systems implementation is a bit long, maybe.
Yeah, great. It's also misspelled. And I think evidence, right, similarly to your excellent comment, take out heart patients, it's redundant. Evidence, as it is, we know, right? That it will be evidence, it's implied. So we have to say that it is randomized and controlled because that gives it value in the eyes of reviewers and editors. It gives it causal value. So a randomized, controlled, but now you're absolutely right, it's a mouthful, health systems implementation. And step wedge is misspelled. So a randomized controlled step wedge, that's how to spell it. And that's important, and it is quite long. Now, there are always things to consider and weigh here. Clearly, short is better, typically. Important also is that we are required to give a very accurate description of our study design. And the more in our evaluation of what is a good design for a causal estimate, the higher we get, the more we want to emphasize the design. And the more innovative we get, we want to emphasize the design. So I think a randomized controlled trial for many health systems journals, many health policy journals, many health and global health journals has a high weight. Trials get preferential review, get preferential publication because they're considered as a very rigorous design. And we can discuss the merits of this. I think it's wrong for many reasons, and many people would agree, I'm sure. This is how the world still is. And if you have conducted a randomized controlled trial, that needs to be set. Now, the step wedge version is a innovative version. That's why I think we have to emphasize it here, and it gets even a bit worse. And I'm just giving you my thoughts sort of as a online joint mentoring. So a randomized controls, it's a cluster, right? A cluster randomized, controlled step wedge trial. This is very unwieldy and it's not elegant. And now there is this trade-off between brevity and elegance and emphasizing in our study design the rigor of the study design and the innovative nature of the study design. So I would probably, in this weighing up brevity and elegance, I would probably keep these adjectives because the tick boxes of design rigor, innovative nature of a design. This is maybe just one other mentoring comment. When we think about science, most scientific grant-giving organizations have very similar criteria of judging the value of a scientific enterprise that is being proposed. And one criterion is innovation? Is it new? Is it new to the world? The NIH, the National Institutes of Health, where I was last week for reviews, calls this innovation. That's one of their criteria. And additionally, the NIH called innovation or asked the reviewer to consider under innovation only methods innovation. That was the only type of innovation that was allowed. Maybe 5, 6, 7 years ago that changed, and they very explicitly allowed also other types of innovation, thematic innovation, maybe policy innovation, right? So they allowed other types of innovation. Still very much a criterion that is evaluated on the methods. Is your method such that the results that you will give to the world is new? Because nobody has ever applied this method. So by scientific process, the method you're applying will make your findings new to the world. They will make it a first in category finding. And here, our innovation is more thematic, but that trials have been talked about a lot. They haven't actually been done a lot in health systems. They're very, very appropriate for health systems. So considerations here, when I'm considering including these adjectives, which indeed are a bit annoying, a cluster randomized controlled step fetch, but is a strength of a method. And now your comment, health systems implementation trial. So I think we don't need both. And I also think let's leave out the entire thing. So I think the reason why Schaukert put in health systems implementation here is he wants to emphasize it's not a clinical trial. But I think because of the causal effect of HIV test and treat on costs, it's clear that it's not a clinical efficacy and safety trial. And then it is Swatini by now, yeah. Any more thinking on your end? Am I right here, or is this still improving? Okay, let's leave it at this. I would be quite happy with this title, right? The causal effects of HIV costs is short, and then there is a longish but precise description of our methods in after the colon. It's not it. So have you brought any abstracts to today's meeting, or who has written an abstract for their paper in this classroom and online? Can you raise your hands? Okay, great. One person who I can see in the classroom and online. Julia, I've seen a paper from you recently, an excellent paper. So you've written an abstract. You've written an abstract. Henning and Elsa, have you an abstract yet?
Not so far.
Okay, great. So then let me give you some background here. Just scientific process-wise, the abstract is typically what editors and the people who screen for editors, it depends on the journal. Many journals, the main editors who will make the final decisions are not the ones who screen the submissions. It is someone fresh out of an MPH program who has taken this as a job for 2 years, screening articles for a big journal. So what they do is they look at the title. They look, which they shouldn't, at the authors and the institutions these authors are from, and will read the abstract. So the fundamental chance that you have to pitch to an editor, or the first stage, the first hurdle that you need to take in getting a paper out, which is editors send it to reviewers, your fundamental chance is the abstract. That is one shot you have. I do not know this, but I am pretty certain, and I have some knowledge, that paper itself is not read. I have the suspicion that in some journals, especially the really big ones, they screen the graphs and they screen the tables also. But what nearly everyone reads is the abstract, right? That is what the first decision is primarily based on, whether an article will go to reviewers. So it's your chance, and maybe often we neglect the abstract for the following reason, which is an understandable reason. We write it last, and that, in my opinion, is the right way to do it. We write the paper, and then we distill the core information in the last stages into an abstract, which is a short version of the paper, and it gives the main value of the paper for an editor, for a reviewer. So the abstract is really more critical than any other part of your paper. Without a strong abstract, you won't make the first hurdle. No one will even send the paper out to review. So that's why abstract is so important. And now, as you can see here, there are two basic types of abstracts. One is a so-called structured abstract, and all journals have the ability to define what structure it should have. Some journals, Social Science and Medicine or Journal of Health Economics, have a paragraph. It's not structured. What does structured mean? Structured means we have different sections that are pre-specified what content they should carry. So very common structured abstract format in our world is the one that is chosen here, with introduction, what motivates our paper, methods, what did we do the study, results, what did we find, and then discussion, conclusions, what are the implications of this work for life, for health systems, for health policy, or for treatments, for FDA approval, and so on. And often a summary of the results one more time in non-quantitative language in a qualitative statement. So this is a very typical type of structured abstract that we see here, but just that you know, there is a completely different category of abstract, the non-structured abstract, which is just one paragraph without the subheadings. Even in the non-structured abstract, these components should be featured. An introduction, why are you doing the work that you're doing? Methods, how have you done this work? Results, what have you found? And conclusions, what does it all mean for this world, for policy, for your scientific colleagues, and so on. So these four components are always going to be in your abstract, I would assume. Shannon, would you disagree in the qualitative world? Are there any conventions that would veer from this overview picture that I'm giving here?
No, it's the same.
Great. Online in the room, any questions about this overview picture? Okay, let's go right into it and do a abstract editing exercise, and let's see how it will proceed. You can still see my screen well, right?
Can it you helps see? When you can tell if you could zoom in a little bit more.
Yeah.
So it basically fills the screen. Yeah, great.
Yeah.
Because when you fill the screen, because we have your picture up covering some of the text now. Okay, that's better. I think we're about to fix it. All right, good. Good.
Great.
Is it good now?
Yeah.
Awesome. So introduction, the first part, why are we doing this work? Swaziland has one of the highest adult prevalence rates worldwide. As Swaziland and many other countries in sub-Saharan Africa have or are adopting universal test and treat or early access to alternative policies, it is critical to understand the cost implications of this change to inform long-term financial planning. The study presented here is one of the first empirical costing studies of EAAA in a public sector health setting. So it's fundamentally right, and I think it can be improved. This is a universal recommendation. It's really important, and you should always keep that in mind, and we violate this rule all the time, and we should not. Our main items, our main things in a paper should always carry the same label. And this is now not Schauke's fault or so. I have introduced a new label. In a sense, it doesn't matter what we call it, right? So this is our exposure, and cost is our outcomes, right? So of the first order are two things: one exposure, one outcomes, one outcome. Throughout title, abstract, body of the paper, and tables, we should always now use cost to label the outcome. That's pretty intuitive and clear. But HIV test and treat, we should now always call HIV test and treat, or we should call it something else, right? And this discussion we can have, and this is sort of domain specific, stick to HIV test and treat, or HIV treat all. There are many synonyms for many in the literature, right? There's universal test and treat. There is treat all. There is immediate art. There is treatment as prevention. They all essentially mean the same policy, and they are legitimate labels that are out there, and good authors use them differentially. In one paper, you should not use them differentially, with the exception of the introduction section, where you could consider a sentence that makes it to the reader that these are all synonyms, but should not be in the abstract, right? So here is a edit that we need to do. I have chosen, so we need to stick to that choice, or to another choice, but we just have one label for our exposure. And I would also be happy with UTT. I took HIV test and treat because Andrew remarked correctly, let's make sure people know it's HIV, but otherwise it's sort of clear what it is. So let's stick to HIV test and treat, but we should now here not get into a discussion of synonyms in the abstract, right? So here it's test and treat, and then there's a synonym for it, or early access to art for all. All good, but not for the abstract. That's for the introduction section. It may be a good idea in some cases to give a synonym dictionary to the reader, right? In this way, are adapting universal test to treat policies. These policies are often called, this is for the introduction section, taking it out of the abstract. These policies are often also called HIV treatment as prevention, universal test to treat, and early access to treat for all, early access to art for all. But here out, and make it HIV test and treat. And this is then the label that we need to carry throughout the paper, always, without exception, except for this one sentence where we give a synonym dictionary to the reader. And then it's Eswatini. This is just because the country has changed its name. And I think this is great. The starting point, Eswatini has one of the highest adult, HIV prevalence rates. We don't need the quantification here. It's more classic if you take it out. But it sort of motivates that there is a major need for treatment because so many people are infected. Can we say this more powerfully? I think it's okay. Swaziland. So here I would just say now, to make it shorter, right? Countries in sub-Saharan Africa or Eswatini. Yeah, let's start with the bigger category. Let's start with Eswatini and then make it broad. So the other countries, that's just policy impact. impact, right? So it's not only for the little kingdom of Eswatini, 1.2 million people, it's for all of sub-Saharan Africa that this evidence is relevant. That is what we're signaling here. That's a powerful motivation by editors and reviewers. Eswatini.
Maybe
like many countries, Eswatini and many other countries in sub-Saharan.
Say other because it's clear it's not the same country. And I find this is something people do a lot. They'll say other or different, You could word out, and you're saying the same thing. So
Eswatini and many countries. The other would be because Eswatini is located in sub-Saharan Africa, right? So if you say Eswatini and many countries in sub-Saharan Africa, it could mean Eswatini is not in sub-Saharan Africa.
Yeah, so that's why I say Eswatini, comma, like many countries in sub-Saharan Africa. And then I think...
Yeah, nice. Yeah, like many countries in sub-Saharan Africa. Very good. F or R, it's too complicated. Let's use one. Either have adopted, many have indeed adopted, and many are adopting. Let's say have adopted HIV test and treat policies.
Has adopted, singular, Eswatini.
However, the
question remain in terms of
the however the cost implications are not known, or however we don't know or is unknown, we don't know the effects. We do not know the effects of this policy on HIV treatment costs.
And here you can see, for everybody in the class, Till starts to use the first person, which I think is exciting and is what more scientists are doing, but we don't do it enough. So you might not see it very often in the literature, but it needs to start coming out more and more. So the use of we in the abstract.
Yeah, and it has a particular also community purpose here in the... So HIV is a particular field and it's a bit exceptional. So I completely agree with Shannon. First person is right. You are the agent of this work. You're taking responsibility, and it doesn't make it in any way better by taking yourself out. That's an old thinking. It's still pervasive, but it's wrong. And I think most sort of major normative bodies on scientific writing, editor boards and so on, have very strongly come out in favor of the first person. And I've been doing this for many, many years, but also over even 4 years, not consistently in all of our own writing, but maybe for the past 10 years, I have not used passive voice and have tried to get my call and PN postdoc students not to use passive voice. Sort of overall, right? There are always exceptions, and it depends a little bit where you are. But it's a major appeal to you. Use we. I like we better than I. I is as legitimate, but we are working in teams. So it signals the scientific team in our, right, with the exception of a single authored paper. So we is appropriate. The V sector, on top of these rationales for the first person, is the community aspect that HIV feels it came from a community advocacy movement. And the V was always with HIV research. And people talk about V in a very large sense because people feel they belong together. So here, V also has that community of people in the HIV world, meaning that's why it's particularly important in our field. And just the last reason, we already discussed that to some extent, and thank you, Shannon, for reminding me. The passive voice is hard to read, right? It makes for cumbersome sentences. So the passive voice version of the sentence, however, we do not know. However, the effects of this policy on HIV treatment costs are not known. That would still be somewhat okay, are not known to us. Yeah. So yeah, it is more cumbersome. In this case, it would actually still be reasonably acceptable. Okay, so I actually think this is probably enough, because if countries are adapting, it's sort of clear that's in the public sector. So I see by here the first draft author, who is a very thoughtful and smart person, puts in public sector, because it is another strength of this study. But here it is sort of implied, if countries are doing it, it is for health policy, and it makes our paper bigger if we don't mention that it is study. We can say this now in the methods. So that's it.
And does it matter, Till, to say the yes. long-term financial planning? Do you have to say, we do not know the effects of this policy on long or short term?
It's a good point. He had included a point on long financial planning. I have taken it out because it makes it smaller again, because also for short-term planning, this is important. And we are measuring here over 2.5 years, I think, approximately. And yeah, from September 2014 through August 2017. So it's not really that by the measures of the HIV treatment needs. This is over decades of a person's life and over at least 50 more decades in this world until HIV has ended, which it will never. So really long-term is not here directly empirically measured. It has implications, right? What we are showing here are probably pretty good estimates for the long-term financial effects, but it's not our focus. And other foci are relevant, right? This will also inform a health system's remodeling, health system's innovations. If it's too expensive, we need models of delivery. So it informs other things than only financial planning in the long term, right? This is one particular value of the study, informing long-term financial planning, but there are many other values, informing health systems remodeling, informing short-term financial planning, informing donors in their negotiations with governments, and so on. That's why I've taken it out.
Okay.
But I think for the concluding section, we could revisit this bit.
Should we get quickly to methods and results?
Yeah, we're already far advanced in time. So from September through August, we collected comprehensive data on facility level prior to and after transitioning to EAAA. It's part of a large-scale randomized effort. Yeah, so here I would start with what is our design, right? These are our methods. So we conducted, and then we just repeat this trial design, and we use the same label. Again, the big labels should not vary in your paper. So when you call your methods in one way, you should always use the same label. So here the label is cluster randomized controlled stepwise trial, which is indeed what this is.
Also, if I can jump in, Till, the most exciting things need to come first. So the exciting yes. thing about this is the design. It's not about September of 2014 and August of 2017. So always avoid that urge to give the factually correct bit of information. That bit of information isn't exciting. Put it at the end.
Yes, great, great point. Absolutely right.
I don't even know if I would include it in the first sentence, to be honest. But maybe that's important for understanding the context of that time in relation to what HIV policy was looking like. You will know that better than me, but I would say it's
yeah. less essential. So now I have seen here, yeah, so I agree with you, Shen. Let's think about that bit, but we made my decision here. We conducted a step batch at first, because it is a official abbreviation. So this part of this method description has to come first. Then abbreviations one place for them, typically no, don't use them. Use them as little as possible. Use only the most well-known ones. One exception to that rule, and this is sort of the art of it, you have to consider that is when it's a label for a method, it makes a strategic point, it makes it appear to the reviewers that they're more rigorous, sadly. So by using a abbreviation, which is an official one, which is common in the literature, we signal that we are methods experts and we appear, it's a matter of appearance, we appear more rigorous. So here in this particular exceptional case, include this abbreviation, with which is sort of an official one, SW and then CRCT for cluster randomized controlled trial. So RCT is the common well-known abbreviation for randomized controlled trial. CRCT, small c, is the official one for cluster RCT, and then StepVeg, ERCT with a hyphen, that is a commonly used abbreviation for this big term. And in this exceptional case, use an abbreviation if it is a method. I would do the same yesterday in my talk at CUNY, right? I say regression discontinuity design, but then I keep on talking about RDD. I do this as a conscious choice to signal, even though it's somewhat wrong, but to signal that I'm a methods expert, right? So the novice will not be in this so often that he has adopted the slang. We should avoid the slang as much as we can, with the exception of method slang, very selectively for big categories of approaches. SWC, RCT, RCT for randomized controlled trial, RDD for regression discontinuity, design, IV for instrumental variables. That is important, and it's a strategic point, not a fundamental one. We conducted a StepVeg cluster randomized controlled trial, SWC-RCT. And then in the public sector, healthcare system in Eswatini's. That was important, public sector healthcare system. And then Shannon, what was your thought? So I think we do need the time somewhere. We could edit, we could comma. Also we could say from, I think it's okay, it's a bit longish sentence, but is there a better way to place the time period? You conduct a separate class in Satie's public sector healthcare system from, I would be happy with this. And then we collected, this is now a next thought. Comprehensive, fine, data on facility level art costs from, on costs on, yeah, so now we have to make a decision again, one label, do we call it art or HIV antiretroviral treatment, and then so we have to, of course, introduce, right, another rule, I'm sure you know it. Whenever you do use an abbreviation and use them sparingly for only the big methods labels and a few very well in the field known abbreviation in the HIV field, art is very, very common. But even the abstract, you have to introduce it the first time you mention it. You have to write it out and then put it in brackets. If you do, you have to do that in the abstract. You cannot assume that people know the abbreviation in the abstract. If you do it in abstract, you still have to do it at the first mention in the body of the paper. You have to do it again. And in part, this is because abstract and body of papers are separated sometimes in the process. In part, I think it's just good practice. Collected comprehensive data on HIV antiretroviral treatment from 14 facilities. So let's say here in Eswatini's, so it's public sector healthcare system. No, I think that's fine. So maybe the public sector we can put in here. So we can make this a bit more elegant. We conducted a separate in Eswatini from September. We collected comprehensive data on under treatment from 14 public healthcare facilities. Yeah, and now this is all good. We used a bottom-up costing approach.
I might just not use the exact same sentence structure as the preceding two sentences, which are subject. And then let's say, using a bottom-up costing approach, this isn't my field, so I'm not sure how the phrasing should go, but
I agree. It becomes boring if you say we conducted, we collected, we used, so we should mix it up a bit. That's an aesthetic point that is absolutely correct here.
So then we kind of change that up, but you're still trying to get the essential information in. In an overarching sense, the method section is kind of long on this, but that's also common. Some fields like to have very long method sections. Qualitative papers generally have longer results sections, but quantitative papers have shorter results sections. But I wonder if we should move to the results section just so there's like at least a feel for what we would want to put into the results section. I know that you're not done with this method section, but in the interest of time, it may make sense.
All good points, Shannon. So let's quickly move to the results section. And here, so method section, it needs to be precise and it needs to be somewhat detailed. Overly detailed. So I also agree with Shannon that what we have left here, so I'm happy with these two first sentences. What is left here needs to be shortened. And I've now introduced repetitiveness. We conducted, we collected, we used, we blah, blah, blah. But here it is already broken, right? The cost included medication. So this would be a nice active sentence that doesn't follow the structure and makes it a bit awkward, right? We. So we is important, but if the sentence structure becomes repetitive, it's annoying to read. So results should indeed be brief, and they can be brief. Even the conclusion can be one sentence. I've reviewed and we've written, just Katie Oldenburg, for instance, one of my former doctoral students, has written papers with sentence concluding section that can be very elegant, right? In the quantitative public health world, short papers, one question, one method, one finding, one implication. That's actually quite elegant.
Yeah, keep in mind, some journals, like we're writing an abstract for AIDS and behavior today, and the word limit is 150 words for the abstract. So you really cannot be too loquacious. You can't be talking too much because you just are barred. They won't allow you to upload.
Right.
Can I just ask two things? Actually, first, can I point out that another thing is the casual effect is probably the causal effect.
Yes. Very good.
The other
casual sex partner, but a causal effect.
The other thing I wanted to ask, I was on the methods section actually, and following from the online course. In order to get away from, because the methods are often, it's hard to write a method section without, if you're writing it completely in the first, the active voice, without saying we at the start of every sentence. So, I agree with using active voice. I'm trying to do it more, but in my method section, veer away from that. I have a lot of passive voice, particularly where I feel like things that we didn't really actively decide. It's like, well, we're following the manufacturer's protocol, so it's not, as an example, we tested urine samples using this testing kit. It was, this testing kit was used to test the urine samples, etc. Do you agree with that, kind of using it? As kind of reserving the passive voice for the methods section? I guess that's my question.
Yeah, it's indeed in the online course a qualification to the universal recommendation to use active voice, first person, VI. That's also strongly argued for in the online course. And then the exception that our co-teacher makes in the online course is the method section. So Andrew, you're absolutely right in this regard. And would actually concur with that. I still do like in the method section, the active voice. So I can see her point, and I think it's right for some components in the method section, and that's maybe a component. So she also says, I'm less strict about active voice when it's about the method section, right? So she minds it less. And it is indeed where she discusses, can we use also passive voice? Where sense. So and you're absolutely right with your examples. I still like active voice in the method section because I like to emphasize our doing. This type of research, right, what you have in front of you is a heck of a lot of work. And it's, you know, smart blood, sweat and tears that people have put in. And we emphasize through we did, right? The we did, we emphasize that we have put in the legwork here to give the world a few numbers. But it's not a few numbers online extracted and then put into an Excel table or an R program, right? This is in the field. So that's the reason why I often in our active field work like to emphasize the active nature. And we do this through this sentence structure. We went out there and trained people, right? So I don't say field workers were trained in the provision of HIV care. I would write we trained 60 field workers in the provision of HIV care because it was a lot of work, right? Someone had to do it and we had to organize it. 10 years ago, I did that myself. And I thought it was important, right? It gives us legitimacy. But great point. So here, my own feeling is V is also very good in method section, but some things such as the choice of a particular assay versus another one are also in active voice, right? So great point, Andrew, and I would in that continuum between not using passive voice at all and considering where might it be legitimate, you're absolutely right, in the method section, but even there, I would typically like to emphasize the active engagement of the team and their partners.
Okay, thanks.
So the causal effect, yeah, thank you. Casual, very important, very embarrassing if we had overseen. And of course, we would have overseen it by standard spell specs because casual is a very legitimate adjective. So the causal effect of HIV test and treat on costs of treatment, on HIV treatment costs or on ART costs. All out was dollar. That's good per patient year. So we don't need to say patient again. It's clear that this is then per patient year. And since the causal effect, there's a p-value. This is right. We do, unfortunately, we do need to write out even confidence interval here. Confidence interval. And I would get rid of the colons as simple as possible, as couple sum as necessary, the first time it needs to be spelled out, but here we can get rid of the colon. Some people even put this together, but I think it's harder to read than separate, but we don't need the colon. Some journals want a colon or want a comma. Some journals here want it like this, right? So look at the journal conventions. In the absence of a convention here, I actually think we have to do two. For the following reason, we have negative values here. So it's confusing, right? This is a negative. Am I right? Is this a negative value? Does that make sense? Yeah, it can be a causal effect. So this is a negative. So it's confusing if you have this, right? Like this and a negative. And then if you have another one, it would. So here we have to say two in our confidence intervals. And getting rid of this and always two, and here also. And Shannon is absolutely right. Here we can have such a short method section, but I see one thing that I think can be easily improved here. Has anyone an idea what we could improve here in the results section? So I would give a qualitative summary and only then the details, because the reader here reads this and initially what you see is $4 and it doesn't...
Hard to put in context.
So I would say average heart patient costs did not increase, or HIV treatment for all. Test and treat. It not art average art patient costs. No, art patients cost. Art average is implied by our design. Art patient costs. The cause effect of the policy change of the policy change. This policy on art costs was $4 per patient years, was small and insignificant. Overall causal effect
and others in the room, I would just say, it seems to me that the HIV field is especially keen on acronyms and has lots of acronyms and lingo that they use with one another. So if you're looking at this and you're thinking, oh my gosh, ART, CI, SOC, EAAA, it is a lot of acronyms also for me, but he's going to be submitting this to an HIV specific journal for whom this is the lingo that they all speak and that they all understand. It would depend on which journal you submit to, how much you could get away with using some of these acronyms.
Yeah, yeah. And less acronyms is usually better, even confidence interval. So confidence interval CI is very common, and nearly all
ART too is
and public really health journals use it. And ART is only common in this particular subfield. So this is... legitimate question that Shannon is raising. I think CI is uncontroversial. ART we could discuss, because if you send it to an HIV specialist journal, JAIDS, AIDS, AIDS and Behavior, it's clear what ART is. If you send it to a general medical journal, not necessarily. If you send it to a journal that is across all social sciences in medicine, right? Social science in medicine, there will be the odd reviewer who thinks ART is a creative enterprise. So the acronyms, it's always very considered choice that you need to take, and the basic rule, as little as possible with the field, not to look ridiculous. So HIV is a good example, even though many of you are not in the HIV field, to write out human immunodeficiency virus every time or even once would be ridiculous. Everyone knows what HIV is in this world. Yeah. Maybe overstating the case only slightly.
This, by the way, brings me back to my comment from 2 weeks ago where I said there is a style book, the Associated Press style book.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, it's no longer freely available. So
it's
available, but you have to pay for it, both the online version and the printed version, which is why I didn't circulate it. So sorry about that, class.
So what I've done here, just to explain, I have given the reader already, and that's in the result section in the abstract, it's even powerful. And the same is true for the result section in the body of your paper. Start with a qualitative summary conclusion, with a synthesis that makes it clear what it means. That is legitimate. This is not only for the concluding and the discussion section. In the results section, we can say, and I've done it in two ways here in these first two sentences, HIV test and treat did not change ART patient costs. That's our basic summary of our results. The overall causal effect of this policy on art costs was small and insignificant. It's again a qualitative summary, and then I give the quantitative summary here in brackets, or maybe a comma here, right? But this has many brackets now, but I think still meaningful, and then we can maybe do comma and p value. So the details need to be there. The results section needs to feature 1 to 3 selected numbers if it is a quantitative article. It doesn't need 5 to 7 numbers, and it should definitely not feature 50 numbers. It's too much, right? So you need to digest it down for the reader. What are the 3 key numbers? Even the 1 number, that's fantastic. So this number here is our main effect size, and it's powerful, so I would leave it in. And now there is something that I would consider: the simple mean cost per patient year across standard of care was blah, 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 compared to. So this is probably good, but I would need to think about it. This one now I'm happy with, because it's immediately clear to the reader what our conclusion is, what have we learned, right? And we do that with the precision in the end of a quantification and a statistical significance testing. That's synthesized in this little addendum here. But all I would tell, right, what in the elevator test, what would you tell somebody? There was no effect, right? So that we need to say first. So let's leave this aside to have a shot at the concluding section.
This is long.
We present the first direct comparison of public. Yeah, so, sorry, there's another set of abbreviations here. Also, SOC is standard of care. That just needs to go out in this one here.
Well, it hasn't been introduced yet either, so I was wondering what it means.
Exactly, and that already shows you how dangerous. So it's already mentioned here, but it's nowhere introduced, right? So this is just plain wrong. Standard of care, often also spelled like this, is SOC, but it needs to be introduced, and I would spell it out here, following Shannon.
And could you just start the conclusion with, if you imagine a policymaker's reading this, you just say, we recommend blank. Because I feel that quantitative papers often have a one sentence, maybe two sentence conclusion that says, essentially, do this. Qualitative papers don't do that as much, but.
Yeah.
And so getting into, we're so novel and we're so unique because we did this, and we found that, and we think this might be due to this, or it could be because of that. That's nice, but if you have a strong finding, just tell people what to do. It's sort of. Right.
Yeah. So here, and let me just get the thought right. This is another just general, but especially important for the abstract, which is the most important text in the paper after the title. The thought first, and then find the phraseology. So Shannon gives me a broad thought, and now to find a conclusion here, right? What is the recommendation? So I like the idea to start with the implication right away with a recommendation. And I'm just thinking out aloud. To me, it would be, we don't need to worry. We, and especially the people who make the financial decisions, don't need to worry that on average patient cost will increase. So either we restate this, it's a bit repetitive, but it hammers home a point. Redundancy is not bad also in scientific work. So we could sort of restate this briefly, or we could say a bit more what it means. So policymakers might not is, right? Policymakers do not need to worry that introducing this policy will raise cost per patient.
Does the class have any ideas?
HIV treat, test and treat. Policy. We could restate it in a positive way.
Have the potential to save
generate the same patient costs as previous, but we have introduced this as art policies, right? It says the world will not change in this regard to this policy change.
Or maybe similar, because it's not exactly the same, right? So HIV test and treat policies generate similar patient costs as previous other policies, while also...
Yeah, so I would call it the same, and I give you my rationale, but I take your point. So to say similar, nothing is ever the same when we quantify. So it is virtually the same, right? So essentially, we will channel, that's one thing we could say to hedge, that would be a hedging, generate essentially, virtually the same patient costs. Now, the case here rests on look at the average patient costs and then look at the effect size. And this is what we need to work on in the results section. The average costs here are 215. And we change it by 4. That's my first case. It is the same. It's virtually the same. It's like 215 versus 219. It doesn't make, yeah, it is indeed 215 versus 219. So this we need to work on. The second case, the second reason why I think it is virtually the same is it's highly insignificant. So within the statistical boundaries of what we can see here, it is in fact the same, right? So so it will generate the same. But we could say essentially the same. So often what I do when it is the same, but the quantities are slightly different, then I say virtually or essentially. And in this online course, the recommendation is to get rid of adverbs. And this is an exception, right? I sometimes do want to qualify an adjective, and it's not elegant to have many adverbs, but essentially the same versus the same sometimes makes for precision. So I think what is here is too much. So I would here just write somehow, again, the thought is you don't need to worry for your substantial planning, right? ART budgets can be extrapolated from past figures for long-term planning. Right? That is somehow can be linearly, right? It's a linear extrapolation. So some, what does it mean, right? ART budgets can be linearly extrapolated. It's again an adverb from past figures for long-term planning. Some takeaway like this. And what else is in here? It's for the first time, even though we would expect. Yeah, this is all too much, right? So here are potential speculations about why we find. I would stick with Shannon's recommendation to make a recommendation, to draw out the policy implications. That's it. This content is important. It belongs into the discussion section.
Yes, and I also find that it's very common to put those why we think we're seeing this statements in the abstract in quantitative papers, but it's not particularly strong. So
yeah, because it's speculative.
Yeah, you're tempted to do it, but the responsible thing to do would be to go and do a small qual to figure out why, or to go back and look at the data and come up with a more robust rationale for your finding. I would avoid doing that in the abstract, but you can maintain it in the discussion section and couch it on findings from other articles that are on a similar topic. But yeah, don't make it just you riffing about why you think this is happening in your abstract.
So this was the last content that was in, and I like it. So I'm taking this, and this is almost all we need for the concluding section. HIV test and treat will generate the same patient costs as previous art policy. Policy patient volume and not changes in average cost, which drive ART budget needs under HIV test and treat policies.
And he'll spell check.
So under. This would be enough. We'll try future ART budget needs under HIV test and treat policies. This would be in, so the concluding section would be fine with these two sentences.
Can I ask another minor question?
Yes.
Yes.
For all the results, the confidence intervals, I'd be tempted to put units on the confidence interval. So from minus 20 to $28, you know? So, I mean, I know minus $28 doesn't make sense, but it does make it a bit more legible to me, I think. I don't know. It's a question.
Yes. So the example, so I often do it and I often change it when I edit papers, when it is percent or so, right? When this is a risk ratio and it's percent, for instance, I often put it here as well. So here, let's think about it. So the minus makes it a bit awkward. It is like this minus. So Andrew, as a response to your question, both is possible. Case by case choice. It is acceptable not to show the units in the confidence intervals, but you can also show them. So I, as a general recommendation, I like it. I'm not totally sure if I like it here, but. Yeah, that's good point. Yeah, makes it less, there's less scope for error, right? If you put the units there. And I often do it with plus sign. I thought it was a bit awkward, but I do think it is better now. Yeah. Great, but please more questions. I have to run soon.
Just one question for the last sentence in the introduction.
Yes.
Where you say, so clearly, like many countries in sub-Saharan Africa has adopted HIV test and treat policies. Because that they adopted HIV test and treat policies is an important part, right? Could you also propose it the other way? Like Eswatini has adopted HIV test and treat policies, like many countries in sub-Saharan Africa? Or what is like the reasoning behind putting it which way?
Yeah. So what you're suggesting, tell me the sentence you're suggesting.
Eswatini has adopted HIV test and treat policy like many countries in sub-Saharan Africa.
The one reason I would maybe consider keeping it as a clause that's close to the beginning of the sentence is because it quickly speaks to a larger relevance. You're moving away from this teeny tiny country, Eswatini, which is an absolute monarch and 1 million people, and it's a little bit of a special case. And so you kind of want to show that this isn't just relevant for this teeny tiny country.
Yeah. So this is really the type of detailed fine-tuning we have to consider. They're all good points. We could even consider this for the following reason. So another recommendation as a general editing recommendation in the online course is avoid sort of long pre-clauses, right? The main clause here is Eswatini has adopted HIV test and treat policies. So a general recommendation is do not put a lot before that, right? So as we know, this is commonly known, or leave that out. Now, in this exceptional case, I think it is okay to put, like many countries in sub-Saharan Africa, Eswatini has adopted, for the reason that Shannon has outlined. The having it after there, all of these are fine versions. I'm just giving you reasons. And in the end, at some point, we make a decision and that's it, right? We can still change later, even in the page proof stages, but here, like many countries in sub-Saharan Africa, it gives that bigger picture why it's important for a big world region where HIV is, right? This is the world region where HIV is and where test and treat is relevant. It's not so relevant in other world regions. And then Eswatini, because we also say Eswatini, we have a sentence starting with Eswatini as a first sentence. So here, actually, of these different versions, this one I like best. But this is at the margin of fine-tuning, right? In all three versions, the one that you proposed, having it last, right, maybe even comma, the other countries in sub-Saharan Africa, it was good in the version that Shannon proposed, Eswatini, comma, like any. It's in general writing, Shannon's version is the most elegant one, right? So a short section into a sentence has often aesthetic value. In an abstract, this version how I like best. Like many countries in sub-Saharan Africa, Eswatini has adopted. But great, great point. And it's exactly the kind of thinking that needs to go into editing. More questions. Online, Elsa, Julia. Okay, great then, thank you. And we will do the following for the next time. First, I will send you the syllabus. Second, we will be online in time with Zoom. Third, you will have homework and you will bring the homework to the class and we will work to this. Hopefully you're getting this. In my German culture and character, we are not indirect people. We say directly what we think. Don't take this as a sign that this is not a totally risk-free zone. We are thrilled with the question. And if I push back on a question, this is just a discussions should go because it makes everything efficient and we learn more quickly. It's totally risk-free and there is no bad question. There is no bad suggestion and we learn together, right? I've learned now from Shannon, from Andrew. Let's be more interactive next time and hope I'm also there in physical form and not on Zoom from New York next time.
Yes, and I have to apologize that I'm not physically there either. So as you all know, I'm expecting a baby and I've had contractions. So my doctor is saying I have to work from home. So I'm sitting here very happily engaged, but unfortunately cannot drive. So
great. Right. Thank you for joining us, Shannon. And I think as a double teaming, sparing team here, we are much stronger because you bring in a totally different, complementary, highly valuable perspective. Thank you for
that. We just need to get the perspective of all of the people in the room. So you guys, come on, open up, ask questions.
When you go to the world and you'll be healthy and everything goes fine, it's going to be a good context. It's already listening to lectures.
Sorry, I couldn't hear that.
I'm wishing her and the child good health, and I said that she's gonna be. I hope she's gonna be fine, and her child comes to the world healthy. And he or she is gonna be a great scientist because already listening to seminars.
Have an active little global health student in 20 years or so, maybe.
Better. Great. Okay, super.
Okay, thanks everybody.
Thanks a lot, everybody, and
I look forward
to my syllabus. I look forward to seeing you again next time. Bye.
Thank you.